So we come to this final plenary session after what I certainly feel has been an overwhelmingly rich and exciting couple of days. And from the buzz I've picked up, other people have too, in ways that will undoubtedly be different. But as long as you've all had some conversations that have, I don't know, switched a mindset, made a difference, made you think in some way, then I feel we'll have done our job. But what we're going to try and do in this last session is not to sum up and synthesize everything we've heard, because I think that's going to be completely impossible. I think it's going to take at least the next year, if not 50, to sift through everything we've learned over the last couple of days. But to hear from some people who are going to offer us some synthetic reflections of one kind or another. So we're going to begin, and this is the bit that I'm going to chair here, with our hunter-gatherers, who, for those of you who were there at the beginning of the first day, you'll recall that I introduced them. They're the people who have been beetling away in the audiences of our various parallel sessions, and sometimes plenaries, desperately making notes, desperately trying to make something synthetic sense of these streams, these five streams that have been running through the conference, which, to be honest, have been not necessarily particularly coherent or fully linear. I think each stream has dotted around. So they've had a really tough task, but what they were asked to do was to hunt and to gather, to pick out gems, to pick out key ideas, messages, things that strike them as interesting, as controversial, as things we might want to take away from this. So that was the task in hand. They were absolutely not asked to provide a synthetic summary. So we're going to hear just a few things in literally 3 minutes each of what they've made of these various sessions. So I'm going to start with the order of the themes that we had and ask first of all Violet Barassa, what did you learn about inequalities and inclusion in this new era that we find ourselves in?
Thank you, Melissa. good afternoon, everyone. I must say it's a really hard task to hunt and gather when everything is a treasure. Everything is really good and inspiring. So forgive me if my hunting skills were not very good and I gathered few treasures that did include yours. But what I think was really a great way for me to synthesize this was to go per stream, a couple of things per each stream. And I was tasked with this big stream of inequality and inclusion in the new era of capital, which had seminars on, for example, revolutions, ruptures, framings, of issues around gender and sexuality. And the debate very much traced the trajectories of gender and sexuality from very much the 1970s, where issues of gender started coming into development much more explicitly, but also the rights and sexual rights of minorities, sexual minorities around the world starting to become center stage. Some of the thoughts that came out quite clearly from all the four very amazing, inspiring presentations were around the need to rethink gender, not as individuals or men, those categories of men and women, but as markets, states, and institutions, because labor markets are bearers of gender. There was also problematic around this phrase or notion of empowerment, and Sunita asked in the plenary in the start of the conference, who is getting empowered, which societies are being empowered, and who is being excluded. In the gender question, there's a lot of initiatives going into so-called women's empowerment projects or empowerment, but it doesn't really come to giving one woman in a rural village in a remote part of Africa a mobile phone. That doesn't mean empowerment in that village or that community, which is more or less what happens. In the sexuality and masculinities, there's a big issue around what somebody said. active legislation that is diminishing the individual rights and expanding the rights of states and markets. So Bafana used the example of South Africa, where legislations around markets and where where the state can access who they can trade with and where they can get money from. So the restrictions on financing and access to markets were removed, more or less, but legislations around individual rights were curbed. Which was summed up very well by Wanja, who said, she doesn't think we're looking back to look forward. We've never moved. We are still here, she said. Dominant masculinities, the dominant narrative is very market-based, a strong man driving the market and women as consumers. And that is very contradictory, because even in the developing world, we have more and more female-headed households, women providing protection that was traditionally an association of manhood and masculinity. So that needs challenging. Whose protection, somebody, whose responsibility is social protection, someone asked in the streams, and there was categorically an equivocal answer that is the state that is responsible for providing social protection to its citizens. How that is done is very country specific, and it's not happening very much, because we can see lots of cuts, austerity measures, not just in the developed world, but very much covertly in the developing world as well. And my last slide is on inequality and conflict, which I didn't do very much because we've just finished it now. Generally, the mood was in a group, the consensus was that there's increasing conflict as a result of inequality all over the world. We've seen the rise in extremism, ISIS, and smaller scale extremist groups. What do we do about it? Narrow down the inequality, economic, ethnic, political inequality gap. Have people participate more, expand spaces for social, civil society, bring the state, the civil society and markets together in a room and dialogue, and that might help, helping the cause. And the last statement is the role of faith and religious leaders. And somebody said that actually, and contrary to what we think, we are moving towards religion than irreligion. The amount of people signing up to look for religious identity has increased by 64%, at least in Africa and Asia. And that means religion is swerving opinions and we can't ignore it. So how do we bring religious leaders and faith leaders on board to chart the way forward for sustainable development? Thank you.
Thanks, Melissa. Let me begin by saying that it was very interesting to hear kind of the diversity of ideas and debates in approaching this triad of states, markets, and society, which was the topic of the conference. I think how I started my journey through this conference was with this question that, you know, the whole processes that underlie this triad include these negotiations between actors. Do we have an understanding of these different processes and the role of various actors? And I think to a large extent, I found my answers in the various sessions that I attended. The first session was on financing innovation, where Stephanie Griffith-Jones very interestingly and gave this concept where development banks need to be created as knowledge sharing platforms. And I think that was something that I really picked up from that session as a financial instrument to kind of tackle this process that underlines this triad. The second session was on political economy of structural change. The question asked was, how can we manage to ensure that the process of inclusive structural change is actually achieved? So in this context, what are the three great challenges of our time? Smart growth, which is better innovation, sustainable growth, which is more green outcomes, and inclusive growth with less inequality. So do we have a framework to kind of understand the role of policy for these three different directions? And I think the answers were mission-oriented role of public finance, public-private partnerships, collective action, all the processes that actually underline this triad. The third session was on Chinese and Brazilian partnerships in Africa. Professor Kaplinsky very nicely gave three interesting evidence of how technologies have been adopted in African agriculture. But a question in my mind as a political economist was, does this, you know, imported technology actually create local capabilities? Is there a way to actually measure and assess, are we actually creating local capability? Another connected question is, can small and medium enterprises in these least developed countries actually link in to the global value chains of the rising powers? And I think that's a question that was answered in that session, and to a large extent in the last and final session, which was on inclusive innovation delivering equitable growth. Is that possible? What I took from that session was that innovation needs to be seen as practice. It needs to be seen as a collective entity. So the answer to if inclusive innovation can deliver equitable growth is that we need to think about local experience. So going back to capacity building and local effect of inclusive innovation. So I'd like to conclude by saying that we need to think of a framework where we think about the processes that underlie this triad of states, markets, and society with capabilities at the bottom of the pyramid. We need to think about economic, social, and political processes underlying this network. And I'll leave you with that thought. Thank you very much.
Right. So based on that, I mean, I was looking really over the last 2 days. 2 days through the lens of accelerating sustainability through different sessions. And Francis Stewart started by saying that environmental sustainability is one of the most overriding issues relevant to inequality. And based on that, she really gave the example of the inequality in emissions per head comparing developing countries to Europe and other industrial states. And then Sunita Narey really questioned the question, the issue of unsustainable growth and putting it as a synonym to inequitable growth, and then stressing the fact that there's a need to think for solutions that really work for the poor in order for them to be to work for the rich as well. Also, she mentioned the question of climate change, indicating that it cannot be mitigated unless we explore the different ways through which we can achieve equality, equity, and inclusive development. She also stressed some provoking questions about how do we deepen the politics that the smallholders can have their voices heard? How can small farmers have an equal stake in the society? And also the state she emphasized the point that the state has become the market and the market has become the state, and exploring how can we actually understand the nature of the future needs to ensure that the poor will be included in all of these dynamics. The sessions, there are four key sessions that emphasize or outline the accelerating sustainability streams. One of them was sustainability transformations. The second one was about the commodification of nature. The third one was about what do the SDGs mean actually to developing countries. And the fourth one was about green transformations and how they can happen. And in each of these, very interesting concepts were explored. In the first session, identifying dominant and transformative pathways were explored through multiple lenses, and indicating that it's not just a single path, it's a process where you have different conflicts and contestations. And we had three different examples, cases from water from India, access to clean water and sanitation from India, access to solar PV in Kenya, and actually access to seeds for the small farmers in Argentina. Although these were very different examples from three different contexts, they really stress that there are some commonalities about the politics of transformation. There's a strong consensus that bringing positive change is possible, but the question of who brings this change, and is it the state, is it the business, is it the society, and how do these coalitions form? In terms of the financialization of nature, there was this statement that commodification of nature is reflected in several markets' forms and interactions, one of the brilliant comments that was made was about land in Africa, indicating that it's not really being grabbed by the global ideologies and frameworks, but rather by locally smart formed alliances, and Zimbabwe was the example for that. Andrea Brock really talked about the question of capitalizing nature for green mining, and she brought an example from Germany. James Fairhead stressed the fact that the development of digital technology is driving intensification of neoliberalism, and he stressed the fact that inclusivity may have a limit, and he made the cause that you have to compare between the included versus the rogue. And then the third session, when I talked about SDGs, giving examples from different countries such as Brazil, Mexico, Nepal, and Tanzania, stressed the fact that there is now this global agenda and all these big words, but now how do they actually make sense on the national and local levels? Is it a political agenda or is it a local process? We need to discover the institutional arrangements that work. Kenya provided a very good example about devolution and how counties do have a role to play in actually bringing change across various sectors. And the fourth session about the green transformation and inclusion, the main question was, do they actually reinforce each other? And we had four interesting presentations about the role of energy, and I mean, one of them in stressed the notion of green enclaves and the need to move beyond just the big ideas of big mega infrastructure projects. I think that's it from the sustainability
lens. Fantastic.
It
was a rich stream. So over to Rachel Godfrey-Wood, who was tracking the institutions, democracy, and their reinvention stream.
Yeah, thank you, Melissa. So I thought I'd identify kind of three trends that were running through all of the sessions on institutions. One was basically adaptability and flexibility. The second was information and transparency. And the third was power and influence. There was a lot of interest in institutions that apparently aren't really adapting or aren't fit for purpose. There was a presentation on international framework, and it was argued that it's basically outdated and in need of overhaul. The session on taxes looked at why certain tax systems aren't outdated. The tax thresholds, for example, set too low in Ethiopia. A lot of countries taxing labor but not taxing shares and capital gains very effectively. But then alternatively, there were other discussions, particularly today, that found institutions that were actually quite adaptive. There was the STEEP program in the Philippines, which had used new technology to help bring health services to vulnerable people after typhoons in the Philippines, and also healthcare improvements in China. So one question would be why some institutions seem to be much more flexible and adaptive, whereas others persist in being outdated. Is it a question of scale, or is it political incentives? The second, information and transparency, because in the taxation, you know, it was argued the main theory is that if there's transparency, if people believe they know where tax will be spent, then they'll be more supportive of paying taxes. But then it was also pointed out, yes, but sometimes statistics do have a lot of impact, but not necessarily in the way you might expect or hope. And we've seen that in the Brexit campaign, you know, the infamous £350 million figure, which was extremely influential. So the question would be, why is it that certain statistics have a lot of political salience, whereas others kind of get ignored or not that used? Suggests to me that it's not transparency, it's not enough, it doesn't quite cut the mustard in it. You've got to look at the ideological context within which people understand statistics to explain why some have more impact than others, and also which actors can influence that ideological context. And that brings me to the third trend, the issue of power. And because it was pointed out at the beginning and throughout, institutions aren't just free-floating, they don't just exist, and even institutions that are taken as given, like market and the state, are brought into being by particular actors. And so some people are interested in why some states are influenced by social mobilizations in positive ways that lead them to be more pro-poor, whereas other people showed a lot of preoccupation with capture of institutions by elites, the media, as Francis Stewart pointed out, or tax authorities that are heavily intermeshed with local elites. And there was a lot of interest in the way in which certain mobilizations from civil society could make institutions become kind of more effective and more pro-poor. And this morning there was also a mention of kind of the role of leaders and visionary leaders, and how you might imagine forms of leadership which are transformative without reverting to kind of strongman narratives.
Yeah. Brilliant. Thanks very much, Rachel. Great. And last but very much not least, we had this stream that was called Citizen Voice, Agency, Accountability, which has again very much been a big theme throughout. And Becky Faith and Pedro Martin sort of did a double act here, and Becky's going to share her thoughts.
Thanks to Pedro for his contributions as well on this. So this was a very live, exciting time to be talking about issues of voice and accountability in light of the Brexit vote. But this gave us an opportunity to reflect globally on issues of accountability and voice, and how are these mechanisms for voice and accountability working or not working, and what questions should we be asking at this critical moment. And in the first session, we were sort of asking existential questions about change and action. And we reflected that in a European context, Brexit was reflected a feeling of powerlessness, and we need to address that. New forms of participation are needed to give people a sense of power. And we also heard about participatory institutions in Brazil and the sense in which they're in deep crisis and that they've expired somehow. So what are the mediating structures that we need to allow us to have conversations with the people on the right? This was an issue that came up. We mustn't be othering people who we just don't agree with. Where are the what we'll call the Habermasian spaces for dialogue? Talking about unruly politics, what kind of unruly ruliness has the staying power to drive change? And there's a danger of falling back on a ruly and ordered form of unruliness. We had the chance to reflect on experiences from around the world, where from Nigeria, as someone said, progressives come to power and the next day you don't recognise them. From Egypt, we're talking about the failure of civil society and progressive movements. Maybe we're so good at breaking things down, but no good at offering viable alternatives. And that's something that came up throughout the streams. But there were some success stories in the realms of citizen voice, agency and accountability, from the Dominican Republic, where participatory governance is working and budgeting, and from the Fees Must Fall movement in South Africa. The next session was on the relationship between NGO, state and social movements and civil society, and some perspectives on engagement with the private sector, networks and relationships. People talking about closing space for civil society in Mozambique, where civil society lacks the capacity to engage proactively with multinationals. Talking about the right to food movement in India, where there's been private sector engagement, but on whose terms, and the threat from a kind of new hegemony which fetishizes evidence-based policy, but can lead to technocratic fixes. And the threats from engaging with market actors, so people talking about the marketization of NGOs as being kind of blind to power and those kind of issues. And then some reflection from civil society in northern countries that recognising that a number of us have, what he said was, crossed the line of acceptability and maybe sucking the oxygen out of their southern civil society partners. In the third session was more kind of instrumental, looking at processes and new research agendas for accountability. So new ways to maybe look at approach accountability across sectors. So rather than looking at a particular accountability in a particular silo, disentangling the stuff of accountability from the people in accountability, disaggregating problems, characteristics, rather than the sector. So you might see stuck out issues in education and in health, and looking for overlapping actors to get greater traction. And finally, a really incredible session, which I can't do justice to, on radical social, political and theoretical innovations from the cities of the South. So looking at cities and the particular challenges they present. Our common futures are urban, and we need to recognise that more and more as our thinking is rooted in rural templates. What's the research agenda that for cities as amplifiers of risk and opportunities? And most of the innovation in cities bubbles up from below, but we don't seem to have ways of bringing that to scale. And finally, really inspirational stuff from Sheila Patel, talking about what works in accountability. So create conditions by which those who've won battles teach each other at the grassroots, whether to do it with policy or negotiating against evictions, rather than having experts coming along and telling people stuff.
Well, thank you so much, all of you. That's five personal, but also I think very helpful to all of us, tracks through this last couple of days, which will be turned into some little blog accounts and bulletin articles. And I put your own personal views into that. I mean, what we also have here is early career researchers who are going to be taking these agendas forward into the future. And I think it's probably you guys that we should be listening to rather than most of us around this room. So, wonderful. Well, if you'd now like to take a seat, I'll call on Ben Jackson, who is the Chief Exec of Bond, which is the coordinating body for NGOs here in the UK, and also who's going to, I think, invite up and then introduce our three final plenary speakers or reflectors. Again, this is going to be a question of remarks and what you've taken from these days. So, Ben, over to you.
Thank you very much indeed, Melissa. I'm afraid I wasn't able to be here yesterday, but even from today, I found it hugely stimulating, and I would say, sort of inhabiting slightly different parts of the development space, but I think all the issues that you're grappling here, you've been grappling with over the last 2 days about a kind of rapidly changing world, what we hang on to, what we need to change radically, and how we need to work together, which I think has been a huge theme, has definitely been something I've found very, very stimulating. And also just to say that I think that IDS itself, marking this 50 years for us in civil society land, which many of our know people inhabit and go back and forth, IDS remains an enormously important place, producing great people, but also great ideas, reflections, and certainly hugely helpful. And we really value the collaboration that we have as Bond and our wider sector has. So we just want to move on to final session. I know people have been working hard, thinking hard, but I've got a great panel here that's going to keep you awake and engaged until we move stagger on to the bar, I think, in 3/4 of an hour. So. It gives me great pleasure to introduce our panel who'll be reflecting and then hopefully have a few minutes just to pick up any last points. So we've got a panel of Nkoyo Toyo, who's a government advisor to Cross River State on Sustainable Development for Nigeria. Deepak Giowali from the Nepal Academy of Science and Technology. And Andrew Long, who's the head of profession for social development at DFID, the UK government department, as you know. So I think I'll start with you, Anko.
Thank you very much, Ben. Let me start by saying how grateful I am to be here, and it's been a big, great pleasure indeed, and very rewarding one for me, coming back to IDS after over a decade and just meeting the community again. It's very rewarding, and going through the rooms and the halls and the hallways, it's been a whole reliving a life in itself. But I think the other thing that I go away with is the sense of we have some of the solutions, we don't have all the solutions, but we do have a sense of hope and something we can hold on to tangibly about where we go forward from here, because sometimes we come to a crossroad and feel maybe we need to rethink what we need to do, and that's what we've been doing in the last two days. And so I take away a sense of, yes, in a very difficult context like Nigeria, and often you must recognize where I'm coming from, the Nigerian context tends to be one that is overwhelmingly difficult to understand sometimes, and therefore a feeling that when you come into the room, what do you really think is going to happen, which is different. And so that's the sense of there are solutions in the world and there are solutions in this room which we take away with. But I also come to this discussion and this experience with the reflections of someone who's a practitioner and someone whose background is largely in the governance sector, and worried about the increasing vulnerabilities of citizens who are trapped in different ways in various shocks that are going on across the world, but more in terms of what's happening in Africa. And where we are being told that, look, inclusive growth is what you need to grapple with some of these problems. But these are not just the only problems. There are many externalities to that problem. We have an array of political, social, economic, and environmental challenges, which the SDG increasingly has brought together into a framework. So the picture sometimes is not very good. Sometimes the picture is hopeless, because the state in which we rely so much on, particularly in our context, is often weak and fragile. The markets are not that strong either. And they're very opportunistic in our context. So therefore, there is increasingly the channelization of the resources which are very scarce in our context for national development, more towards and more the misappropriation of those resources and the use to advance very narrow agendas and narrow interests. However, I did come across some very strong views which helped me in rethinking some of these things. James Mano's point about the constructive potentials of the state being underestimated is something I take away with. It demonstrated that in four contexts where they had evidence of, there's been huge redistribution of wealth, reduction of poverty, impact on inequality, and the capacity to reach the poorest of the poor, which means the state still has some value. Reinforcing also this belief is Mariana's point about how we can rethink the public-private deals and how we can get state actors to be more confident, mission-oriented, and directional in their engagements with the market and how they determine those outcomes which come from there. Today again, I reflect on Bayo's point about the need to return to social bargains in which we bring back the public values to all economic imperatives and the market. These logics seem obvious to many, but the challenge often for us is how do we transport and transit from the thought process and the frameworks and the things we come out with into the real world in which we live. And that is really the way the things gets a bit murky, the waters get a bit murky. And to do so also, not just in the sense of the experiences of the many that have worked, but also in the experiences of those places and context in which it hasn't worked. So context and localization is very important. And maybe that is why I find it very fascinating, the themes that have arisen from James Ferguson's lecture yesterday about the possibilities that exist in Africa. Possibilities particularly not from the ethnographic treatment of welfare programs that he treated so well, but more the political implications and potentials that this has created, particularly for development practice and anti-poverty activism. Today, again, and I haven't had enough time to digest the rich work around cities, the incredible state of joblessness, the youth bulge, and the many other issues of migration from the rural to the urban, which create new poverties. And we're asking ourselves the question, is poverty urbanizing? And where do we deal with these types of things? So these remain questions which challenge even the situation in which we find ourselves. But then back to what James says about how do we then get the bottom to become a bit more radicalized. We in the context of Africa have not, and in contexts like Nigeria, have not been as fortunate as the Latin American countries to have had the social movements that led to the kind of politics that we saw in Latin America. So how do we get that bottom to begin to become where we begin to get things to happen? Because that's where the mass of people are. That's where the mass of the problem is. And that's where the change really needs to happen, the transformations really need to happen. And then there is something that I think James touches on. And increasingly, it's becoming a phenomenon in Africa. The modest, small amounts of payments that are being made in non-threatening ways, it doesn't change significantly the interest and political interest and configuration of politics and power in our context. Small amounts, something as little as $50, transfers every month, are beginning to raise some attention within our context. And I believe that depending on how it's structured, this indeed can create radical possibilities and lay the foundation for possibilities and radical possibilities. In Nigeria, we're having for the first time ever significant attempt by the government, a new government has come in, to reach 80 million people with some forms of, eight million rather, in 1 year alone with some form of social protection. What does this mean? It means that they can reach the extreme poor, they can bring women increasingly in from the informal context in which they are into more established context within that same formal environment. They're reaching poor people with what they call homegrown meals, and a mixture of other more productive forms of trying to reach young people who are unemployed and who are increasingly moving from the rural to the urban. I think the paradigm that we're seeing here is that on the one hand, a lot of discussion about the tenets of production or productionism and what we heard about it in the urban context, where the urban context shows very clearly that there is a lot that we stand to benefit from understanding what is going on there. But also on the other hand, we begin to see what is going on when kingship organizations and kingship relationships or relationships of persons are raising some sort of reciprocity, which is taking care of the absence, more or less, of wage labor and providing alternatives for very precarious livelihoods. And that's the point James makes about the construction of what he calls a distributive political economy, one which has the potential to cascade wealth in different levels, distribute them, produce complex relations of dependency, and also create smaller forms of resources that cut across different levels of society. I think this appeals significantly to us in the sub-Saharan context. And I would like to say very quickly that this is not a phenomenon that is just limited to Southern Africa, although his work has been largely in that context. It's something we see increasingly even in our own situation. And not increasingly, but more historically. Take, for example, the over 2 million internally displaced persons as a result of Boko Haram in the northeastern part of Nigeria. Just the dispersal of those numbers into host communities and just the size and responsibility and manner in which societies and communities have been able to cope in terms of managing that without a formal system of redistribution of wealth or support which is driven by government. So this in itself is demonstrative of the nature of those relationships that he talks about. And therefore, I take away with me the feeling that there is underpinning something about the ambiguity of the informal, which we need to understand better. And this not in itself, it's a very contested space, which we also need to unpack in different ways. What in that context is legitimate enough for us to hold on to and to use in terms of building this redistribution of wealth, and what are the things which we need to really put aside, and what framework works in that context? And how do we begin to make sure that even the internal contradictions within the different context in which we're trying to use these types of resources to drive a certain engagement with the bottom is being used in the sense and provides a certain scale to it, which is also demonstrable. One of the things we went away from our meeting as alumni in Nigeria was a strong recommendation coming from the MDGs that we need an incentive-based collaborative policy. We need incentive-based collaborative policy instruments. So this whole thing about the use of social protection and social and cash transfers feeds into that kind of very incentive-based collaborative thing. So, but therefore, we are left in a situation where we begin to ask ourselves, what's the framework for capturing this? How do we capture this in our context? We see the value in it. We know it exists. We've seen it work in the case of a lot of the internally displaced communities in the last 4 years. Much of what is going on is where these kinds of support systems have existed. And the question is, how do we formalize, or should we formalize, or how do we energize, I would rather say, and how do we create the agency from below which puts a certain kind of demand on the formal systems? But it's not as easy as it sounds. We have in the country also the inequalities that are special. The Niger Delta is raising its own claims to the resources of the country. How do you bring in a national context, where subnational contestations for that same resources existing in a very different direction? It's not about the unifying ability of that resource to deal with the broad context of poverty and deprivations that exist, but where people in themselves are saying, you can't use our resources in the way that you want because these are resources of our region and we need to think about it differently. So again, it's about how do we deal with this? How do we get state-led systems like this to address the risks, this whole risk distribution process, and actually make them sustainable? How do we go away from the captures that tend to exist in certain contexts? who is taking what and who getting what. Which of course takes me to the question of, is this also an opportunity for us to begin to think in a broader sense about this whole issue of the basic income grant for Africa? Is it something we can begin to think about? Is it something too far away for us to begin to think about? And if we do think about this, what are the potentials? And just to take us a step back on that, why not, if not? The PRSPs were brought to Africa, and we did everything that we're asked to do around the PRSP, and look at where we are in the continent. So why can't we begin to think in terms of what frameworks will work for us in terms of engaging with a certain basic income regime? Maybe I should end by saying that we do not have answers, but we know that there's something going on there. And this is the interesting thing I take away with. There is a possibility there that even in the most difficult environment, there is energy to bring people together and create a system that begins to engage the people with government. Because the distance between government and the people is a hugely problematic situation for us. And to end here in the language of the SDGs, I think we have a responsibility not to leave anybody behind. And in trying not to leave anybody behind, this research is critical to bringing people into the main discourse of development. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and Koya. Thanks very much. So we'll move now on to Deepak. You're going to be up there? Yeah. Okay, right.
Conference like this depends on where we come from and what we intend to do. And what I have heard has excited me quite a bit, simply because I now realize that the windmills I am fighting against, there are lots of other people fighting those windmills. That's quite exciting. The biggest regret is that I couldn't clone myself into five and attend all the parallel sessions. I would have been five times more excited if I could have done that. Now, what have I learned that's exciting me? My own windmill that I fight is what I call, among the different windmills I fight, the madness of runaway technology. Now, what is a runaway technology? It's a technology that overtakes the interest of society. The interest of technology becomes paramount. Okay. What we have in much of Nepal, India, Gangetic place that I know, the first picture you see is a traditional technology. Even now, about 80% of hill irrigation in Nepal goes by these brushwood dams. I call them disposable dams because water is needed only in the dry season when the rivers are low. And these brushwood dams divert the river, the stream, and the farmers get a second, third crop, and they've been doing that for centuries. The trouble is everybody has problems, and they have problems too. There is declining volunteerism. Labor in the cities means that, you know, you earn money there, why would you spend 3 days working for a community, whatever system? And so the managers of the system have a lot of problems trying to get voluntary people to come and do the work. So they want labor-saving technologies. So they come to the Department of Irrigation or Ministry of Water Resources, where there are people like me trained in the best universities in the world. And we have never been taught brushwood dams. I have not found one university or engineering college that even discusses this. What we are taught is ferrocement technology. That's the only one we know as water engineers or civil engineers. So here's the other picture. In 1961, a certain aid agency that shall remain unnamed and lead them to the limbo of ignominy built that barrage on that same river that you have the brushwood dam a little bit upstream. In 1961, and in 1962, the river moved away, leaving it as a monument to man's stupidity that you can still see east of the town of Butwal, east and south of it. Now, you would have thought, you know, civil engineers would be taught, you know, not to build these heavy permanent structures on a Himalayan inland delta fan, because these delta fans move all the time. But that's what they did. Now, that is the comedy part. The tragedy part of it is they destroyed the irrigation system that existed before. And the farmers lost their livelihood. The area descended for the next 20 years, the Marchwa region of Rupandehi, into a dacoit-infested area, the same as the Somali coastline where, you know, when
bad dumping of pollutants on the Somali coast because the state had disappeared after the bombings, meant that the fish disappeared, and the poor fishermen of Somalia who could fish, that's the only thing they knew, now started fishing for bigger fish, tankers, much more lucrative. That's what they did here also in this place, because people have to survive. Okay, and when the state comes in with that kind of a wrong technology and destroys livelihood, people survive. It took about 20 years later with many other things going on, but one important factor was the entry of the market, the seductive technology called the Kirloskar pump. Okay. There's some, what, 50, 60 million of them in India right now. It's very seductive, and that's what market does. You know, you can't buy one, well, you can rent one for 50 rupees an hour. It comes on a bullock cart, and the area is swimming in groundwater anyway, so you just put in a bamboo and start pumping. Okay. Now, you can see that there are three types of technology choices by three different social solidarities, the voluntary civic society, villages, the big agencies of government, engineering, and then the market. Okay. So you see that there are three different types of choices going on, but then one choice dominates, ferro-cement technology. Massive big dams, engineering. And that's what market is all about, international market. The World Bank is now in glee saying we are returning to big hydro dam building up there after being bashed up for about 20 years. But then re-entering without picking up the lessons they have learned about what development really is and what it is that people want. Okay. So what happens in these three different social solidarities? Bureaucratic hierarchism, market individualism, and activist egalitarianism. They are so designed that they see the problem very differently. And they each have institutional filters where certain data is information and certain data is filtered off as noise. And the problem is they all do their filtering in very different ways. The Greens do it one way, a hydrocracy does it another way, you know. And a market that's selling its product does it very differently. And they don't want to challenge or upset their own cosmologies. And these institutional filters also lead to what is called institutional blindness. At the last session, that exciting session on cities I was in listening, you know, Sheila Patel was mentioning that you have thousands of people living on the footpaths, and they're completely blind, the state is completely blind to it. They don't exist. I have been on Gandhi and Padyatras on the Gangetic Plains, where the British in the 19th century relocated certain people into a village to do transplanting of salt forest, teak forest. And we did the Padyatra about 10 years ago. This is about over 100 years. And those villages are not even on the census map of India. Thousands of people living in those villages, and they're not even on the census map. They don't exist. Okay. Now this kind of institutional blindness comes there. But what is also more important to realize is each one of them is using, and in this conference, one exciting thing was the re-entry of power. Also love was talked about, but power. And it's high time that power became an object of analysis. So far, political economy was sort of sidelined by pure economics that talked only of the mechanics of everything. Now we're talking, we're saying, no, we've got to get back to power. But when we do that, we find out that each one of these solidarities uses very different types of power. Bureaucratic hierarchism uses the coercive power of the state and its procedural rationality in that way. You break the law, you go to jail. That's all they know. Markets use seductive, persuasive power. And as the Kirloskar pump shows, it's very convenient. Your iPads, iPhones, you know, you name it, bubblegum, anything. Okay. That's what markets do. And activists use ethical power of critique. They're a pain in the butt most of the time because they critique. But that's what they do. That's their job. So there are three different types of power that you see at work here. And that means there are three different types of innovation also. We talked in this conference very much about innovation. Market hegemony has meant that innovation generally is only about iPads and iPhones and, you know, what these clever devices that that markets bring up, technological innovation. No, that's one type of innovation. There's a big need for managerial innovation,
with bureaucratic hierarchism, because you cannot manage today's problem with yesterday's tools of management, which is what governments are trying to do. Doesn't work. You have to come with innovative new managements. And where is that innovation taking place? Not much. You need ethical, you know, innovation, behavioral innovation with the ethics community. And that only comes from things like religion, spirituality, ethics, you know, all kinds of crazy things like that, where behavioral changes are brought about. You can't bring behavioral changes only by coercion. Okay. So these are the three types of different innovations that need to come about. And what we find out is, are we there at that perfect nirvana of the title of this conference, State, Market, and Civil Society? No. What this conference also showed is that there's a tremendous distortion of dharma, as we call it. Now, dharma is a word that's very badly and wrongly translated as religion. It's not true. Dharma is a way of life. State bureaucracies have a way of life, an ethical way of life that they should conduct themselves. Markets have an ethics and an ethical way they should conduct themselves, and so do civic movements. The trouble that we are seeing is there's a distortion in all of them in this triangle. There's a tremendous distortion. Governments are no longer Burke's trustees. They are rent-seeking license raj. Civil society is not really civil society. There are bongos, dongos, gongos, and pongos. In Nepal, the biggest problem right now is pongos, party-organized NGOs, business-organized NGOs, government-organized NGOs, and donor-organized NGOs. It's a huge distortion of civil society, which is giving NGOs such a bad name that it's almost become a pejorative now. You go to villages of Nepal, and you say you're from an NGO, and the word used against them is dollar kheti. Dollar kheti means harvesters of dollars. You know, so there's no longer that, you know, we are from civic movement or we are all these ethical guys and all that. That's out, that distortion. And markets are no longer markets. They're crony capitalism, very bad crony capitalism. So with this distortion of that triangle, the dharma gone wrong, you find out that huge amount of people get squeezed out in this process into fatalism. Oh, what's the point going to vote? What's the point doing this? You know, nothing will change anyway. Okay. But then the trick now is to figure out how do we restore that dharma. And each one has to be restored. It's not just the government, it's not just the NGOs and civic movements, it's not just the market, all three at the same time. Now, how that big challenge, and what I heard was exciting over here, is that the balance can only come about because there's a big acceptance in this conference that market and economic hegemony is the problem right now. We need markets, we need the economics and economists, yeah? But then there is, allowing a hegemony is not a good thing. We got to bring back, reintroduce ethics and interdisciplinarity. And we got to get the other social sciences, the other disciplines contributing to this restoration by redefining the problem from their own perspective. And finally, I would end by saying that in the last panel, I'll just take the last panel because every panel was so exciting and the last one is stuck in my head. The cities panel that I attended, the whole idea is now for organizations like IDS and all the partners around the world that we're collaborating with, the main dharma here should be to generate uncomfortable knowledge. Because comfortable knowledge probably got us in the mess we are in. And it will not get us out of the mess. Now, how do we generate uncomfortable knowledge? True to being a Karl Popperian in the sense that we should be bold enough to generate outrageous hypotheses, not to defend them, but to falsify them. So as a scientist, I should come out, it's my dharma, to come out with the most outrageous hypothesis I can think of and challenge everybody and myself go into that challenge of trying to falsify it. And until it is falsified, it is true. The moment it is falsified, we go into finding something else, some better science, okay? Now, in the cities panel that I attended, and this is where I'll close with, I come from two mafia strands of urban studies. One is called cities as a force for good. Some of us argue that too often cities have been seen as a force for bad, congestion, crime, etc. But if cities were to be a force for good, CFG, what do we need to do to re-engineer cities and their infrastructure and institutions? And we have all kinds of crazy ideas, including banning the use of the word waste. There's no such thing. There's only nutrient recycling, and have you done it or not? And we have all these kind of crazy ideas. We also argue that the other stream is what we call Desa Kota, which is from Bahasa Indonesia, means neither urban nor rural. You can go to a remote village, and if you use your eagle eye science of satellite mapping and all that, you'll see a remote village 2 days from, or 3 days walking from the nearest road, obviously rural, right? But if you use the toad's eye science that some of us toad's eye scientists do, you'd go into that household like a little worm or a toad and look at the income basket of that household 3 days walking from the nearest road in remote Himalaya. And you'll find something very strange that eagle eye science cannot figure out, which is that income basket will tell you only 40% of the income of that household is probably coming from the rural areas. 60% of the income is coming from Saudi Arabia, Qatar, Malaysia, Korea, even London here. Now, is that household rural or urban? 40% rural, 60% urban. And that's what their aspirations and everything is like. Hence, the need to think of urban and rural as vanishing ends of a spectrum, with everything else gray in between. The moment we do that, we find out our urban studies department and rural development departments go out of the window. We need to redefine these things. Okay. So that is why I'll close with an example of, while we're doing the Desa Kota study, of Baluchistan, where they have these karejas, or kanats as they call them, these underground water channels. The funny thing is, they're all in decline because of market pressure and everything and pumps and all that. But what is funny was they have the kanat, the karejas, Loya Zigra type of a gathering, once every 2-3 years, whatever. And the funny part is people do come. Even though it's not giving much water anymore, they come in because it is their badge of citizenship, their belonging. And the funny part is, you know where they come from. They fly in from London, where they're running travel agencies and all this, from people from Baluchistan, they're running travel agencies or restaurants or something in London. But they come there because being there is their identity and their badge of citizenship. Now, this is the kind of stuff that, very toad's eye science would allow us to get in. And I was excited that this conference was able to weasel in into that area. Thank you.
Okay. I'll look around and see everybody if I can. Thank you. Thanks very much. I'm going to take something of a different tack because DFID and the Department for International Development, part of the UK government, and IDS have had a very long relationship. And when I was asked to make some comments and so on at the end of this 2-day conference, I thought, well, it's difficult for me individually to do that. So actually, I consulted with colleagues and. So I've got a combination of things that I'd like to say, which don't necessarily reflect some of the excitement I've had over the last couple of days and some of the interest that I've rekindled in a way over the last few days. But they're sort of taking a slightly longer term perspective. So it's a combination of things. I want to say something on behalf of DFID, and I can speak on their behalf in this particular gathering, and then say something more personal, because I've actually had quite a long relationship myself with IDS over the 12 years I've worked for DFID. I've led on research programs, and I've had the pleasure of being jointly involved in running conference sessions for advisors and so on with a wide number of people from IDS, and so I'd like to reflect a little bit on that, if I may. So first of all, I'm going to just say something about DFID's sort of perspectives, and this is really a selection because, I only had a limited response from colleagues. And so this probably won't necessarily capture everything, but nevertheless, I think it's important to share this with you. I think, first of all, it's very well recognised within DFID of the unique and sort of sustained relevance and impact on the way in which we work and think, in fighting poverty, on tackling social and gender inequalities, on helping citizens to have voice, and in the current kind of the current narrative in DFID, the voice choice and kind of greater control over their own lives sort of narrative, and promoting sustainable development. So, I mean, there's been a long and unique kind of engagement on these questions, which we've entered into dialogue with IDS on. And I think, as an organisation, IDS has also continually pushed the frontiers of development thinking. I mean, we had a session this afternoon where one of the panellists actually said that they felt somewhat as though their own work had, and thinking at IDS was nowhere near revolutionary enough, and that they talked about tweaks. They only talked about tweaking things. Well, actually, when I've reflected on a personal level, but also contributions from others in DFID, the impact that IDS has had are by no means tweaks. And I think the following will help to illustrate this. First of all, I think it's worth pointing out and recognising Robert Chambers' work over the last four decades. I mean, it's really inspired people-centred approaches to development practice and spread participatory methods in research. And I think many in DFID would say to you that actually this is really, you know, they've really been galvanised by Robert Chambers' work, either as students on short courses or as readers. And 40 years is by no means, you know, 2 days conference. So I think it's worth reflecting on that. I think IDS has also changed the way in which we look at, and we've changed worldviews on social protection. I think the work of Stephen Devereux and Rachel Sabatis-Wheeler from 2004, the paper that they wrote on challenging perceptions of social protection, social welfare programs for poor countries, arguing instead that it can be affordable and socially transformative, was a seminal piece of work, which is still oft quoted in DFID now in the evidence that we produce in these business cases we all have to write to generate approval for spending. Not insignificant. That goes back to 2004. I mean, 10 years ago, Mick Moore set out a vision for the role of taxation and machinery of development and state building, aided by research that was led here in the International Centre for Tax and Development. And this has become a central part of how we now understand finance for development. And particularly the emergence of work over the last few years, really on the kind of self-funded exits from poverty that we're trying to engage with. I think the work on citizenship, participation and accountability also delivered a compelling range of studies exploring the dynamics and outcomes of citizen engagement across the world. And Gaventa and McGee's 2011 paper and review of the impact of transparency and accountability initiatives really set a global benchmark in this area. It's often referred to in different... I mean, in my world, the social development world, the citizenship, participation and accountability work really is known by everybody. And then more recently, and I think it's worth reflecting on this, Melissa Leach's own work and that of fellow anthropologists, you know, providing real-time, rapid advice and guidelines to policymakers and practitioners during the Ebola crisis, you know, increasing the effectiveness of medical and humanitarian responses actually saved lives and reduced the spread of illness and disease. And I think, you know, this work's been recognised by UK's Parliamentary Committee and Report on Science in Emergencies. This is not insignificant, this is not a tweak. And I think it's fair to say that much of this, and other work, late Sue Unsworth's work on governance, politics, fragile states, Lawrence Haddad's work on research and advice on poverty, food insecurity, nutrition, and more. You know, recent work from IDS and the partnerships they've been developing with China and the development influence of the rising powers, all of this is consequential. It's not tweaking. And I think it also demonstrates, you know, the importance of longevity in research and relationships, something that I think IDS has really been able to demonstrate the value of. So I think that it's worth then just saying, you know, kind of in sort of summary in reference to DFID's overall view on this, that IDS has played a very special part in the evolution of knowledge within ODA and then DFID, you know, including hosting DFID's development library for a number of years and facilitating guided reading weeks for staff and so on. And I wonder if this is a way in which we could consider, you know, IDS being somewhat sort of more revolutionary in the fact that they've actually been able to infiltrate the state in this small but nevertheless consequential way. So some personal reflections. I think first of all, what's most significant for me, and this may well reflect my own disciplinary habitat, if you like, as much as anything else, but actually it's about the conduct of research. It's about how research is commissioned, delivered, and so on. That I think IDS has been able to provide a really significant contribution to. And that really is around shifting, I think notably shifting power relations in the construction and generation of knowledge. I mean, it was notable for me today and yesterday to see how many panels were represented by alumni, but also by scholars, practitioners from the developing countries themselves. And I know that that was really something which was absolutely at the heart of the work on citizenship, participation, and accountability, but has permeated, if you like, the whole of IDS's kind of modus operandi. So it's in the conduct of research. Now, I often think of research probably idealistically, not just as product, not just as the product of, but as a process. And I think of this as development. I think of research as development. I think IDS have been able to demonstrate that in spades. I think that in other ways, in more specific ways, perhaps. I mean, there have been numerous examples that I've had the good fortune to be involved with, where scholars from IDS have kind of willingly given their time to come in and help us think through challenges, think through problems. I mean, the one that was most notable for me that actually also made a significant difference to, I think, the way we were approaching our gender work in the Middle East, for example, was that, I mean, it's from Maris as well. I mean, she came in and helped us think through for the Middle East Department, reconfiguring, if you like, a gender strategy based on the notion of social justice, because it has much more salience discursively and otherwise in the Middle East context than a difficult notion like gender. So, and there are numerous instances of that. I mean, recent conversations with John Gaventa about questions on inequality in our thinking through how are we going to try and design a research program which will help address, you know, this conundrum about, you know, an overbearing focus on growth, not understanding really the kind of growth inequality nexus and why there isn't this kind of growth transmission to poverty reduction. So numerous conversations I've had with John about that have really helped us shape what we've been doing. And it's that generosity and that generosity and belief in sharing and in partnership, I think, that's really come through in myriad examples of that kind. And then I thought, well, there's a question that's been raised, and it was even raised, I think, in James's lecture yesterday about the notion of discourse and the way in which discourse works. Is discourse also changing discourse? Is that a way of thinking about, you know, infiltrating the state? And I think the short answer is yes, actually, because discourse matters. I think the way in which we articulate things, the way we narrate things, the way we frame things in our mind, the way that's manifest, symbolically and otherwise, and particularly in context of practice, really matters, because it's that old adage about, you know, there's nothing as practical as a good theory. You know, it really does matter how we frame things. And so I think that, you know, in DFID, we explicitly talk about power, and we have done for years. It's in our political economy analysis, it's in our social and political analysis, it's in our gender and social exclusion analysis. It's underpinned by understandings of power, a lot of which has been generated by staff engagement with IDS and others. I think it's right to say also that, you know, for many years DFID has been a very government focused, you know, we focus on working with government. That's what we're a government, for goodness sake. That's what we do. But I think over the years we've actually realised that there's been that we need to shift away from focusing on and largely focusing on working with government and think more about state-citizen relationships. Now, the last articulation of a state-building, peace-building framework kind of started to pick this up, but it didn't do it in as nuanced and as sophisticated as a way as some of us would have liked it to have done. But nevertheless, I think it was, you know, it's a journey, if you like. But I think the ways in which we are now much more critically thinking about, you know, political settlement being about citizen-state relationships and so forth, and is really important. And it does demonstrate, I think, the ways in which we kind of our language and discourse is changing around our engagements, and that has practical implications. And I think a lot of this is you know, we have a new economic development strategy, which has a very large chunk in it on inclusive growth. Now, it's not going to work for everybody. It's not going to be a perfect fit. Never is. But I think it helps to encapsulate the ways in which a lot of this thinking has started to come together now around our core strategies. And I think it's true to say that, you know, there's been a revolution in thinking about politics within DFID, which is really informed you know, our strategic and sort of programming and policy choices over the years. So let me end with two things. I want to just sort of focus on future challenges because I think it's you know, it's useful to. I mean, it strikes me as perhaps strange that we think power is something that we need to focus on that's new. It's not. So I say that I think one of the things for the future is to continue to focus on understanding new constellations of power and its many disguises. Now, when I was an undergraduate, some, I don't know, more than 25 years ago now, John Gledhill was my tutor at the University College, and he used to talk, and he wrote this very interesting book about the disguises of power. So that's, you know, close to more than 25 years ago. But I think we still need to focus on it. So whether it's new or not is irrelevant. It is an absolutely critical issue. And we need to continue to focus on that and do so in the context of the economic, political and social changes that we're facing that have been so and that have been so eloquently articulated over the last couple of days on the state markets and a conference. So I think the global goals was a very interesting session this morning, actually. I think the key thing in all of this is to focus on the relational concerns between goals. It's too easy and too heuristic, if you like, to sort of separate these things out as though they kind of can stand on their own terms and we can measure them. And then we can demonstrate progress on one if we don't deal with it in isolation. So I think that extreme poverty, inequality, security, climate, environment, gender, and the intersections between all of these, I think is really important. And I know that given the kind of the realities, the complexities of the world we actually live in, that are often at the heart of the research and teaching that IDS have been doing, this will become one of the things, I think, which will be an important framing. So I think that new demographies and geographies of poverty, we've talked about a lot over the last few days in different ways. And I refer to, you know, an increasing focus, say, on poverty and conflict and fragile affected states, the urban question, the demographic shift, the youth bulge we've heard on a number of occasions and so on, the interesting presentation that was given yesterday by James Ferguson on joblessness. And I think it's important that, you know, development continues to address the needs and aspirations of the poorest and powerless in this context. I think that's something that, you know, we don't want to lose sight of in our concerns for other global challenges. I mean, this underpins them all for me. I think new technologies and communications, the kind of digital world, is something which is, in a way, too obvious to state, but on the other hand, it's not that obvious at all. It's actually quite, I think, much more nuanced than we think. There are risks and challenges in this. I'm concerned, for instance, with questions around access and accountability, inclusion, around the kind of digital revolution, and there are risks. Communications of this kind present risks as well as they do opportunities, and I think that we really, you know, that those new frontiers are all things that I think we're going to need to engage with, and present us with a really challenging kind of set of research opportunities. So finally, I'm just going to say that I think it's absolutely, without doubt, DFID will continue to have a very strong partnership with IDS, and will always continue to explore opportunities for mutual learning, sharing challenges and robust debate. So I think, in short, we will remain critical friends. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Andrew. I'm just looking at Melissa. Do we still got a few minutes, do you think? Or
I think let's take 10, just in case people have other
So what I want to do, just for the last bit, is we were thinking, it's not really a question session. It's an opportunity now to five. John's
five.
Right. Okay. Fine. Okay. Well, you've got to be. I'm going to say. Well, I want short fire, literally one liners now. Just in the light of all of this, what is the sort of research and knowledge agenda going forward? Maybe not quite for the next 50 years, but certainly for the coming period. Anything people want to kind of almost shout out? Just one liners that people think we need to remember. Yes. Here.
I have the microphone. Well, one line first, saying that I'm very grateful that we've had this exposure to the IDS culture and over these 2 days for those of us who've not been part of the alumnus or part of IDS for too long. The two reflections that I have on this. One, the kind of majority that, for example, we've seen in our country in 2014 when the present Reiter's government was voted into power, or what the Brexit here shows us, what that nature of discontent is not from the poorest. It is from somewhere in between.
Right.
And they we tend to dismiss as the lumpen, or you know, see them with contempt. And,
okay.
But we need to understand that.
Right.
And that does seem to have a power of changing.
Okay.
So if instead of allowing the writers to take them over, if we were able to influence in some, so the pathways need that we need to address may come from understanding that right. mindset and their meaning of life.
Okay.
Third, just as a, on that, the development
third one,
that we still seem to have, largely both by the states and the market, and even large parts of civil society, the vision of development seems to be the 1950s development model
yeah.
still.
Okay.
And that vision, that colonization of the mind has still not transformed itself.
Brilliant.
Until we do that, we'd still need, so the inroads on those are probably...
Brilliant,
directions.
Fantastic. Okay, any more over here, I'm looking. Anybody else want to give us a one-liner on future adjustments? Yes, here. Please keep it short, just let others come in.
How are we going to get beyond looking at GDP, GNP growth as the source of development, the measure of development, and related to that, the 50s model of export-dependent, growth-centered development?
Brilliant. Okay. Peace on that. Anything else for future agendas? Yes, here, this gentleman here. Fast with the mics, please.
I just want, first of all, to say thank you for the opportunity. And IDS has really created a very big network out there in the name of alumni. I know there are a lot of research projects that are going on in different countries. But my inspiration is that the alumni ambassador concept is something that we continuously need to invigorate so that we can be able to tap from the alumni and the champions that we have around the world. And I think that is the way we can be able to tap new knowledge, new experiences, and be able to enrich, you know, research with practice as we go along.
Brilliant.
So secondly, and lastly, and finally, is
NGOs talked a lot, but go on.
the SDGs. Okay, we had a very brief session this morning, but I think I just want to say that they have not created a wave like the MDGs. Is an area that as we go along we need to continuously see how we can transform so that we can get real changes to communities and also to states, because the relationship between the three actors is very fluid. Mm-hmm. And if we have to move forward with vigor, then we need to create a wave of transformation so that we are able now to change livelihoods and
great.
You know, and be able to learn from it. Thank you very
great.
Much.
Great. So there's a piece about the policy, the practice, yeah. and the research piece, and keeping that fantastic cross-reference. There's a piece about the kind of slightly Masonic thing about the IDS fellows, but Masonic fellowship for progress and social good, which I think is great. Any other last points that people want to do about chance to shape IDS's agenda for the next 50 years? Yes. Melissa's writing it all down. Stand up.
Connecting this alumni network with current students.
Brilliant. Fantastic. Right, there's a model for you. And you can get two more in if you're as short as that. Anybody else wants a quick last word on the future agendas for IDS? Yes, thank you.
Hi. To take up the challenge of methodological innovation, so if we're talking about different paradigms, if we're talking about power and
okay.
nuance and process, then how do we actually do that?
Brilliant.
We need to innovate.
And literally the last word, anyone wants to have that? No pressure. But no, it can be big or small. Any other last points?
Amen.
Thank you. Yeah, amen. Thank you. Richard Jolly is... amen. Yes. Thank you very much. Good. Okay. With... with that, all it takes for me is to thank our panel for their reflections to go forward and pass back to Melissa to close events finally.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you for this fantastic last panel and also to Ben. I'm going to steal three last words because I can. What struck me about this conference, just some words that one is left with. I think we're talking about a triad of state market society, if only to argue with and to argue about the relationships between them, often antagonistic. I think we're talking about the fundamentality of politics and power all the way through. I think we're talking about transformations, not tweaks, in a context where the challenges, inequality, unsustainability, insecurity are really, really urgent. I think we're talking about a role for research which is about linking it up with practice, with networks, with revolutions. And actually, the word love was used in our fantastic SDG session this morning. To me, love, an emotion, gets connected up with the intellectual in something that's maybe about passion. And I think there's passion aplenty in this institute, in its alumni, in its students, in its partners, and may it continue into the future. Finally, the other thing I have loved about this conference, 10 years ago, IDS 40 conference finished with a plea that IDS should cease to be development studies qua the study of southern countries and developing countries, and should take on what we've come to know as a more universal agenda, development for all everywhere. Since then, of course, we've had the SDGs arguing that case. But what I've loved this in this meeting is that nobody's questioned the fact that we are in a world where the challenges of inequality, unsustainability, insecurity, political difficulties, state and civil society, are just as relevant in the UK, in Europe, in the US, as they are in Africa, in Asia, in China. So let's embrace that. We're in a new era where development and development studies affect us all and where we can all learn from each other. And so please let that be a mantra that we take into the next 50 or more years.